Good morning.
Good morning.
Please join with me in the call to worship. O God, how manifold our works. You have made them all in wisdom. The earth is full of your creatures. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. Let us worship God. Let us pray. All the earth is full of your glory, O God. The heavens resound in praise of your name. Brooks ramble along the course you designed for them. Leaves whisper of your manifold ways. Fields murmur as you pass through them. In the skies, the thunder sounds its applause. With countless tongues and voices, creation welcomes your presence. We join that throng and lift up our chorus. Praise God, from whom all mercies flow. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of confession. God of wisdom and understanding, have mercy upon us as we confess our sin. Your children are scattered. Language keeps them apart. Forgive us for the barriers of insensitivity that repel those you seek to call through us. By your Spirit's power, undo the plight of Babel by the miracle of Pentecost, to the end that all may hear the gospel and praise the risen Christ with one voice. As God confused the languages of the earth to keep the people from idolatry, so God sent Christ with the universal message of salvation. Whoever calls on Christ's name shall be saved. Brothers and sisters, trust that name and be assured, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. The peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Greet one another in peace.
I'd like to invite the children that are here from Sunday School to come on up and sit down. We're going to have a time of recognizing our Sunday School and our Sunday School teachers and our nursery helpers.
So if we could have our Sunday School teachers, Lee Mason and Joanne Crawford and Amy Lawson, come on up and get ready to share with their students this morning. We'll let Amy go first. I know. Do you want me to read them for you?
I can handle
it. Oh, you'll be good.
I got Emily.
There you go.
Okay, first we have Sawyer Kenzer. Sawyer, come on up. Colton. Jordan, but I don't think she's here. Emily Guzzo, I don't think she's here. Cameron. Ashton. Nathan. And Aubrey. And that's it.
Good morning. First off, I want to say a few things. I want to thank everybody for bringing me their children. And the pleasure I've had teaching them is beyond words. And we need to have all of them every Sunday because I need to be happy. It's not all about me, really. The first little girl I have is Grace Kapling. Is Grace here? And we will send the certificates home so they all get one. Jay Dunbar. Garrett Gorsuch. Cadence Gorsuch. Lucy Husky. Elizabeth Martin. Olivia Martin. They come together. Camden Romano. There's Camden. Alexis Savage. Isabella Stratton. Tiffany Stratton. Dress. Parker Talentino. Jeremiah Wanzer. There you go. Did I miss anybody? First, second, and third? Good. Thank you very much, parents.
Good morning. Lee Mason, I taught the third, fourth, and fifth grade. My wife, Christine, also helped teach the class. She wasn't able to be here today because she had to work. Also wanted to thank Hannah Gabbard, who helped a lot when Christine wasn't able to be there. We had a good year. We started out in the fall talking about the Old Testament, the stories in there. In the winter, we moved into the New Testament with the birth of Jesus and in some of his teachings. And of course, then with Easter, the crucifixion and his resurrection. We talked about that as well. Then after that, we kind of alternated between the Old and the New Testament. So they were able to see quite a bit of what's in the Bible. Had a good year and want to give you the certificates to Olivia Hollinger. I thought of it. I readied it. Olivia Laurie. Olivia? Okay. Tyler Dunbar. Jonas Wells. Gabby Gorsuch. There you go, Gabby. Chris Pierce. James Husky. Kyle Alexander. And we're back. We'll mail the ones to the people that weren't able to be here. Oh, we got one coming. Okay. There you go. You bet. Also, would like to say the same thing that Joanne said. Really appreciate the parents making the effort to bring their kids here each day. I really appreciated having the chance to teach them in the class. Thanks. Oh, want to give those. Yeah. These are for our third graders. Okay, Tyler Dunbar and Gabby, I'll have you come back up. As third graders, they get these booklets. Okay. And the last one is going to be for... we got one for Olivia, one for Tyler, and one for Gabby. And Gabby, you've got yours already. And we'll see that the other students that aren't here get these. Okay. Got yours? Okay. All done? Thanks.
And I'm shorter. I had the privilege of teaching the kids in middle school. And we talked a lot about concepts this year, especially that God is in control and that God loves us and that we should live in the Spirit and always to respond in love. And because it's Pentecost, the kids are going to get a hat hook today that's a flame to remind them of the Spirit in their lives. And a lot of them do like to hunt and fish, so it kind of looks like a fisherman's hook anyway. So, Jake Hubbard. Samantha Hubbard, Kyle Husky, I saw you come down, Sydney Kenzer, Brooklyn Mackin, Thomas Martin, Dakota Sharkey, Victoria Vining, Sophia Wells. And that's it for my class. Again, it was great to have them all there. And we hope to see them again next year. Oh, all right.
As much as they all appreciated teaching your children, we appreciate them and their teaching efforts. And we have a little gift for them, for our teachers as well. And also, Mary Moran. Are you here, Mary? She might be in the nursery, because we do have a gift for her in the nursery. So we'll make sure that she gets that as well, and we thank her for her time and dedication in the nursery. So to Lee and Amy and Joanne and Jean, as well as Emily and to Hannah, still back there hiding, we thank you for your Sunday school service and the things that you do for us, and you deserve a big hand. You can go ahead and sit down. I won't torture you anymore. So to the kids, I have something special if your name is on my list. This is Sunday school attendance. And if you were here 25 or more Sundays, you get this really cool candy bar. All right. If your name is Cadence, see Miss Melissa. If you are Gabby Gorsuch, and Victoria, and Colton, and Sawyer, and Sydney, and Olivia and Elizabeth Martin. These children all attended Sunday school 25 Sundays or more over the last year, so they get lots of chocolate. We do have some nursery helpers that we'd like to recognize. Michelle Johnson was one of our faithful helpers in the nursery, as well as her daughter Danica, and Joanne and Emma Lucier. Not sure if they're here this morning. And Jamie Guzzo. Where's Jamie at? Is she in the nursery? She's not here either? Okay, all right. There you go. And Caitlin and Kelsey Moran also were very helpful for us in the nursery. And is Douglas here today? No. Oh, man, we got something for him, too. So we have four special young people in our church that are graduating this year, and prom was yesterday, and Hannah, I think, is the only brave one that got up early to come, so she gets to be recognized as our graduate this year. So Hannah's graduating from high school. We do have gifts for Trace Sanderson, as well as Caitlin Moran, and for Danica Martinchek. What's the secret? Oh, yes, VBS is coming up. If you have not registered your children for VBS, it's the week of the 24th of June. There are registrations in the back narthex that you can fill out, and that for your children. We appreciate your time in that with our bringing your children to church and sharing them with our teachers and with Sunday school, as well as the congregation. We all are here together to help raise them in God's love and in His hands. We will have an ice cream Sunday making bar downstairs after church. So keep sermon short.
Yeah.
but we are going to take the kids downstairs for some Sunday school fun, so they will be able to come on downstairs. And I have some more prizes for them for later. But thank you very much.
Please be seated. Our first New Testament lesson today comes from Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 14. For all who are led by the Spirit. Excuse me, got the wrong, didn't quite flip right. Okay, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with him, so we may also with him be glorified. Our second New Testament lesson today comes from Acts chapter 2, starting at verse 1. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all gathered together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each one of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at the sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one of them heard them speaking in the native language. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? How is it then that we each hear in our own language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own language we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'What does this mean?' But others sneered and said, 'They are filled with new wine.' But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, 'Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken to the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.'" Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 16. Starting at verse 4. "But I have said these things to you so that when the hour comes, you may remember that I told you about them. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asked me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin because they do not believe me. About righteousness because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot yet bear them. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." Let us pray. Lord God, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It was a beautiful day when I was in college, and we were on one of the beautiful grassy fields on campus, and we were playing a pickup game, tough touch football. Now, this particular day, I happened to be playing wide receiver. Now, when I played wide receiver, I usually ran the short routes. I'd go up 10 yards from the line of scrimmage, then cut either to sideline, and then I'd quickly look for the ball. Or I'd just stop after 10 yards and look for the ball. Now, I didn't get a whole lot of separation, but my body was big enough to be between myself and the defender and the ball, so I could catch a lot of passes underneath. But usually, in almost every game, there was at least once or twice that I could beat the other team deep. Now, if you're sitting there and you're thinking, now, wait a minute, I thought the people who caught the passes downfield deep were the ones who were fast. And if you're sitting there thinking to yourself, you don't look like you were very fast, you're thinking either of those, you would not be wrong. In fact, you'd be right on both accounts. If you want to threaten the field downfield on a continuous basis, yes, you need to be fast. However, if you're sneaky, you can get away with it at least once a game. And that is by having the guy run one direction and you run the other. It was the end of the game, and because of the score, we decided that the next score would win it. And so I knew this was the perfect opportunity. I told the quarterback what I was going to do. I came off the line like I did all the other times before, although this time a little slower. So the defender was right on me. And then when I went to cut, he saw his opportunity. He undercut me. He got in front of me. And of course, he was looking to the quarterback because he was just hoping the quarterback would throw it and he would intercept it. Just at the time as he turned his head and his body and started running to the sideline, I turned and ran upfield. And before he knew what happened, I had a 10-yard head start on him. Now, if we'd been running a 200-yard dash, he would have caught me and beat me, obviously, probably even a 100-yard dash, but there was only 30 yards left to the end zone, so I knew my stubby little legs could get me there. So I was running for all I was worth, and when he saw what happened, he actually stopped running fast and he started jogging because he knew there was nothing he could do. And so as I got close to the end zone, I decided, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to look back and watch that ball in my hand. So I ran, looking back like that, all the way for the last 15 yards. And the quarterback threw an incredible pass. He didn't try to zip it to me. He lofted it out there so I could run underneath it. And I was just sure by the way that the ball was coming that this was going to be a sure touchdown. And just as I was watching it fall over my shoulder into my waiting hands, all of a sudden, the ball went bing off this huge metal post, the ones with the lights that are 25, 30 feet in the air. And I realized in an instant that I was just inches away from running into this pole. Now, since my hands were on either side of the pole, I couldn't get my hands in front of me to stop me. And I knew there was no way to change course or direction at this point because I was running as fast as my stubby little legs could take me. So I knew I was going to crash into that pole. You know, they say that in most moments, it seems like an eternity. It did seem like there was a lot of time because I had time to think through the situation. I thought, if I run into it like I am now, I'm going to hit my nose and my mouth against this metal pole. And I thought, that won't be good. My teeth could get knocked out. I could have all sorts of problems with that. And then I thought, but if I lean my head forward just a little bit, it'll smash into my forehead and nose at the same time, and it'll save my mouth. Whether that was a good decision or not, that's exactly what I did. And it was just like the cartoons. Because I was running as fast as I could, I literally wrapped around the pole just like you see on the cartoons when someone runs into a pole. My arms went around it, my legs went around it. I slid down onto my behind, and then I looked up. And because I'd hit that pole, it actually was wobbling a little bit. And as I looked up there, the first thought that hit me was, wow, I haven't been hit that hard since football. And then as I continued to look up, I thought, wow, I don't think I've ever been hit that hard. About this time, everyone else who was playing caught up, and they wanted to know if I was alive and what was wrong and what was happening. And one guy said, oh, do you feel okay? And I said, yeah, I feel okay, but I know my nose is broken. He said, oh, you don't know that. And I said, well, yeah, I do, because I heard it. And I had a friend who was playing with me, and so he decided it was his responsibility to get me the emergency room. So we walked there as I was bleeding, and we waited not very long, actually. Then I got to see a doctor. And of course, the doctor started by putting a bunch of injections in my nose to numb it. And then he started moving. It felt like he was moving my nose all over my face. Now, it's at this point that I heard the nurse say to my friend, maybe you better put your head between your legs because you look like you're about to pass out. It was enough for my friend to see him putting the needles in my nose, and then when he started moving it around, that was too much for him. So I told him, I said, you've been a great friend. You got me here. You got me medical attention. You don't have to sit here. So he was more than happy to leave the room. And then the doctor asked me, he said, I have a student. I'd love to bring him in here as a teaching opportunity. I thought, why not? Someone should learn from this stupidity. So he brought his med student in. And then what followed, I have to think, was one of the greatest teaching lessons about noses of all time, because in the next 30 minutes, he was moving my nose all over my face, it seemed like, and he was pointing things out to this student. But there was a little bit of a problem with that. After about 30 minutes, I could start to feel him move my nose all over my face. It was clear the anesthesia was wearing off. And so I looked up at the doctor and I said, could we finish this up? I'm starting to feel this. And I'll never forget this. He stiffened up and he gave me the most grumpy look that I've ever seen in my life. It's at that point I wanted to share a few more words with him. But I knew two things. I was laying on my back and I needed someone to put my nose back in place. So this was not the correct time to get in an argument with the doctor about patient treatment. So he quickly put my nose back where it was supposed to be. That day, I suffered quite a bit because I was looking back instead of looking forward. And as I was on that table, he was fixing my nose, I wasn't going to repeat that mistake. I wasn't going to look back and not forward and let that anesthesia wear off so that I felt the full force of that nose being put back in place. Sometimes in life, when we're looking back, bad things happen because we're not looking forward. But there's other times in life that looking back is a great thing. When we look back at the history of nations, we learn all sorts of lessons. When we look back on our life, we can learn all sorts of lessons. Hopefully, we see the things that we did wrong, maybe areas we can improve. There's a lot of information. When they teach business courses in college, they go over examples where a small company grew to become this great company, and how did it happen? Or how did this great company turn out to go bankrupt in only 10 years? There's a lot that we can learn by looking back. And we as Christians do a lot of that during the Christian year. We have the whole season of Advent, and then of course Christmas, to look back at an event that happened over 2,000 years ago. And then we have another season, Lent, and a day to look back on the resurrection of Jesus, which happened almost 2,000 years ago. We do a lot of looking back in the church, and hopefully that time is put to good use, and we learn a lot, and it's edifying, and it helps us as Christians. But we also need to look forward. And that's what the day of Pentecost is all about. It's about individual Christians and the church looking forward. A few years ago, there was a movement in Christianity called the What Would Jesus Do movement, WWJD. And if you came to a point in your life where you were not sure what you should do, you were supposed to ask yourself, well, what would Jesus do in this situation? And then, of course, you were supposed to follow what you thought Jesus would do. One of the criticisms of that is people would say, well, I don't know exactly what Jesus would do in a particular situation. And that's a pretty good complaint. There are some situations where we don't know what Jesus would do in any given or particular situation. But the truth is, as amazing as it sounds, you are better off today than if Jesus was sitting right beside you. That's an amazing thing. You are better off today than if Jesus was sitting right beside you. Now, if I was just saying that, that'd probably be a very bad thing to say, and I probably should have my pulpit privileges taken away. But it's not me saying it. It is, in fact, Jesus Christ himself. In our gospel lesson today, during the Last Supper, when he was giving his final instructions to his apostles before he was betrayed and killed, what did he tell them? He told them he was going away. And just as he had told the crowd, he was going away someplace that the apostles couldn't follow him. And what happened? How did the apostles react to that? They got sad. They got desperately sad. They felt the sadness in their bones because now Jesus was going to leave them. And how did Jesus respond to that? What did he tell them? He said, I tell you, it is to your advantage. In other words, you are better off if I leave. If I don't leave, the Spirit will not come. And then he goes through to explain to them why the Spirit coming to them is actually better for them than if he continued with them as he had for those 3 years. Did you know that you are better off today than if Jesus was sitting beside you? It's kind of a difficult concept, but that's what Pentecost is all about. The day of Pentecost is the promised day where God poured out God's Spirit upon all flesh. And as if we didn't get the point, God says, I'm going to pour out my Spirit on both men and women. And as if that wasn't close enough to the point, he said, both old and young, and that your young men and women will prophesy, and your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. And if that wasn't clear enough, God says, even upon slaves, I'm going to pour out my Spirit. Even the lowliest of the low in the community, I am going to pour out my Spirit. I'm going to pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. The day of Pentecost is our day as Christians in the church to look forward. Because on that day, when the Spirit of God was poured out not only on them, but also on us, we became part of the story. We don't have to look back at the sacred history of what happened before us, because we now, with the Holy Spirit, are part of that sacred history. Each one of us is writing lines or verses or chapter in that sacred history of what God is doing in the earth. That's how special the day of Pentecost is. As we saw all the kids up here and we celebrated their participation in Sunday school and the Sunday school teachers, we know as we look at them that that is the future. And as individual Christians in a church, we're supposed to be looking forward. And that's what the Spirit of God is all about. The Spirit of God is promised to us so that as we look forward, as we start to write our own lines and our own chapters in that sacred history of what God is doing in this earth, that the Holy Spirit is always with us in a very powerful way, present every second, every moment of every day. And believe it or not, you are better equipped with the Spirit to do God's will. You are better equipped to be part of God's sacred history. You are better equipped to know the will of God in your life. You are better equipped to carry out everything that God has called you to do because the Spirit has come than if Jesus Christ himself was sitting next to you. Do you feel better off? If you don't, and many times we don't, maybe it's because we haven't taken this promise that Jesus gives us as serious as we should. Because Jesus himself has promised us we are better off. And maybe it's because we don't see ourselves as part of the sacred history. That's something that's happened in the past. But the Spirit emphatically tells us we are part of that sacred history now. Maybe it's because we haven't taken advantage of the Spirit in our life. And that starts with just realizing that the Spirit is ever present with us. It's ever there to help us. It's there to help us to guide us. It's there to help us to comfort us. It's there to help us understand the will of God. It is there to make sure that we run that race, that we finish that course, that we all receive that crown that Paul talks about in his letters. Do you feel better off? The day of Pentecost is a day when we look forward, both as a church and as individuals, and if we grab on to that promise that God has given us, that promise that Jesus Christ himself made us, we will know that this day and every day forward, we are indeed better off. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for coming and blessing us, not only with your teaching, but with your Spirit. And we pray, Lord God, that you'll open us up to that presence. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
We love God.
Please join me in the Apostles' Creed found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Reminder once again that we're going to have a little ice cream downstairs after church, if you'd like to go down and join us. The deacons will meet in the Westminster room today after the service. So I don't know if the deacons need to go down and get ice cream first or go to the meeting first. I'm sure you're supposed to go to the meeting first, though. Any other announcements that anyone has? I would just like to make one announcement. We had Presbytery here yesterday, and I just want to thank, again, all those individuals who work so hard. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday for Presbytery, we had a wonderful hosting event, and people talked about how wonderful a hosting job we did. So I want to again thank all those people who put in a lot of extra hours for that. Are there any prayer requests today? I get something to write with. Maryland snack. Yep. Anyone else? Okay. Let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we come before you thankful for the gift that you've given us, the gift of calling us to ministry, and the gift of equipping us in every way with your Spirit. We thank you for all that you went through and suffered so that we could receive the Spirit, a Spirit that would rest upon us in every way and aspect that it rested upon the apostles and the great prophets before them. We thank you, Lord God, that this Spirit also is not only there to equip us and to guide us and direct us and to comfort us, but it's also a sign of your promise that you have declared each of us is a son or a daughter of the Lord Almighty. We thank you, Lord God, for this gift. We thank you for the working of God on the day of Pentecost so long ago, where the Spirit of God was indeed poured out upon all flesh. We pray, Lord God, that in our daily lives that you will open our eyes and hearts and minds to the Spirit, to its leadings, to the promises it gives us, to the comfort it has for us, and to the eternal promise that God has chosen us and has an eternal destiny for us. We pray, Lord God, not only for our church and for our individual lives, but we pray for others who are struggling and going through difficulties. We pray for Marilyn, we pray for Margaret. We pray for others who in our thoughts and minds who we know are going through difficulties. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And we also pray this day, Lord God, on this day when we remember our teachers, we pray a prayer of thanks for them and their dedication, for the gifts that you've given them, and we pray that you'll continue to bless them with your Spirit. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. O God, to you be the glory. We live to praise you. We trust your judgment. In all that we do, we seek to obey you. Receive our offerings. They are the gifts of your Spirit. You have wrought the wonders that accompany new life. We shall not shrink from giving you glory, for we are called by Christ to be the stewards of what you create. Amen.
Thank you.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.